I'd like to start off by considering a little bit about why we perform real ear measurements. Now, there are a lot of different reasons and explanations as to why we do this procedure, and different people will give you different answers to this question. Somebody might say that it's in order to match the hearing aid to target. Another person might describe it as how we fit hearing aids. And you'll find around the globe that real ear measurements are sometimes part of national or local guidelines. But what is it all about? One of my favoured explanations is this, that it's about confirming the hearing aid is performing in a certain way that actually provides benefit. For me, this explanation encompasses both the purely clinical task that we have as clinicians, you know, making sure that the hearing aid is working, but it incorporates the patient side of it as well, in terms of thinking about what benefit actually means, and that the purpose of fitting the hearing aid using real ear measurements is confirming and ensuring that that benefit is received by the patient. So when we fit a hearing aid, really what we're trying to do, it's an attempt to overcome hearing loss. Now, we've got our normal hearing range and we've got an audiogram on the screen that shows a mild to dipping into severe in the high frequencies, sloping hearing loss. And what we're really trying to do with a hearing aid is restore this hearing loss to as close to normal hearing as possible. Obviously, we all know that a hearing aid is only an aid, and we need to be aware of the limitations. So the likelihood of restoring fully natural hearing is restricted. But this is what we're aiming for, and what we're trying to overcome is this deficit. But how do we know if we've actually done this? How do we know if we've achieved this with our hearing aid programming? Well, we've got two options. There's validation or evaluation, some people might call it, and there's verification. So let's talk through validation. Now, this could be something like a cortical assessment, aided cortical assessment. It could be speech testing, could be using self-reporting measures, questionnaires, but it generally tends to be some kind of functional assessment as to how the patient is doing with the hearing aids or aid on and in place. To really perform sort of accurate and scientific validation, you do need some kind of acclimatization period. Sometimes it's perfectly possible to perform it immediately after fitting the hearing aid, but if you get poor results, you don't get good results, there's always that question mark in our minds about, well, if I did this again in maybe 6 to 8 weeks' time, would the patient have acclimatized and would I then see better results? So the safest time to do it is at that later stage after they've had a period of adaptation and acclimatization. Validation measures often represent binaural listening situations, whether that is speech testing or some kind of descriptive self-reporting measure. We're looking at how the patient manages with both ears, whether those are aided or not, whether you've got one hearing aid and one functional ear or one aid and one ear with a hearing loss. We want to know how the patient is managing in the real world setting. So it is possible to do this in a monaural way, but typically and most often, the most useful information we get from the validation process is binaural information. And there's usually some degree of subjectivity. So self-reporting measures or questionnaires obviously have a subjective element to them. But even speech testing, sometimes the audiologist or the clinician's interpretation of the results can have a subjective element to it, particularly if there are challenges to do with accents or speech problems, then it's not always as straightforward as it could be or might seem on the surface of it. And these measures usually require some element of cooperation. Even corticals, which are ideal for maybe an infant population where they aren't able to take part in more active speech testing, there is still cooperation required. So it is it's a procedure that involves the patient to be involved in some way or another. On the other hand, our verification process is really looking at, you know, is the hearing aid producing the desired output? And this is where our real ear measurements can play a part. There isn't any requirement, that there's no delay, there's no requirement for acclimatization, so we can perform the verification of the hearing aid output at the time of fitting the hearing aid or upgrading a hearing aid or changing settings. And it provides us with monaural data, so real ear measurements gives us information about each individual hearing aid that we are assessing. Real ear measurements provides us with some objectivity, and it really does require minimal cooperation, even in young infants or children or patients who are not able to sit still for long enough for full real ear measurements. We have the option of coupler measurements. So why does verification matter? Isn't validation enough on its own? Well, as I've mentioned previously, there are the differences between the two types of assessment that make each desirable under different conditions or situations or circumstances. But we have huge variations between people. That could be differences in ages, genders, sizes, hearing losses. And our real ear measurements, our verification process, allows us to overcome that. One of these aspects is ear canal shape and size. Now, some people have much larger ear canals than others. Other people will have smaller ear canals. And if we think about age, that's a big effect here. Some people might have a wider canal than somebody else, and other people might have shorter or longer ear canals. And there's also shape to take into account. And this can have an impact on sound as it travels towards the eardrum. What we really need and want to know is the sound that reaches the eardrum, because this can vary between individuals, meaning that the sound delivered by the hearing aid is not necessarily the same as is received by the eardrum, nor is it going to be the same for each person. So what we really want to do is take into account the acoustic properties of the ear canal. So we can use real ear measurements to establish the level of sound that reaches the eardrum specifically. We do this by placing a small tube that acts as a microphone. This gets calibrated to render it acoustically invisible. And we can record this measurement unaided, which tells us the natural resonance of that person's ear canal. And then we can insert a hearing aid and measure again with the aid in place and switched on. This tells us the level of sound from the hearing aid reaching the eardrum. And if we aren't happy with the level of sound that reaches the eardrum, we can adjust the gain of the aid, remeasure, until we're happy with the level of the sound. This is where prescription targets come into play. We recommend using DSL or NAL, as they have a large evidence base behind them. And this gives you the best chance of providing the optimum amount of gain across the frequency spectrum, which should provide the benefit that the patient requires. So that's REM in a nutshell, but where does it fit into the bigger picture? If we look at our typical patient pathway, REM will fit into the amplification stage, but it's important that we don't see it as a one-time only procedure. Because, as we know from earlier, REM is about taking into account the acoustic properties of the individual's ear canal. So it's important that we redo our REM measurement whenever we suspect these acoustic properties are likely to have changed. This can be when we think the ear has changed shape or size, and this is very common in our young patients. And in the very youngest infants, this could be as much as every 3 months as they grow very quickly. As we get older, this time interval can increase. However, if we change ear tip or ear mold, this is another important point when REMs should be performed. The change of tip or mold can affect the acoustic properties as measured at the eardrum. And if the audiogram changes, then a recalculation of the prescription is required. Sometimes very little to no adjustments are required, but it is only by performing the real ear measurement that we can be sure of this, and we have the scientific evidence to support this. So we've been talking so far about REM largely as a clinical tool, but there are other perspectives with which we should consider the value of REMs that go beyond the clinical domain. In this day and age, there are much higher expectations from the end users. There's a lot more awareness. People talk a lot more about hearing loss and having hearing aids than they may have once done. The internet has given and will continue to provide people with more information about what they can expect from their audiological assessment, their audiologist, and their hearing aids and rehabilitation process. More and more people will be expecting REMs to be performed. When it isn't performed, they will be questioning why. There's also a much greater emphasis on value for money. This is a valid point for both independent hearing aid dispensers, where an individual pays directly, and public health systems, where people have already paid into the system via taxation, for instance. People are demanding more, even if they aren't paying for it then and there. So now I'd like to hand you over to the very capable hands of Dennis Mistry, the Clinical Product Manager for the Hearing Aid Fitting Product Range at Interacoustics, who will take you through how to perform a real ear measurement on the Affinity Compact.
This video explains the process required when fitting hearing aids on a patient's ear using an Affinity Compact. The on-ear fitting process involves several steps in this order. First of all, the selection of audiometry. Secondly, choosing the correct target. Third, probe tube placement. Then the measures real ear unaided gain, then real ear occluded gain. An optional step following these of calibrate for open fit based on the measurements before. And then finally, your aided measurements and your target match. All of these steps will be explained further in this video. First of all, in your patient management system, select the patient you wish to fit your hearing aids for and launch your Affinity Suite software. Your software will start up in the audiometry screen, and your audiometry is your starting point for hearing aid fitting. It should be performed to the best detail to ensure the best fitting and reduce returns from your patients. You can choose to perform the audiometry from scratch or select the audiometry session that you wish to base your fitting on. On launching the REM module of your software and selecting your test protocol, you'll be prompted to select the fitting prescription. There is a lot of choice surrounding the fitting prescription, but we recommend choosing NAL or DSL algorithms, as these are both evidence-based targets which give a good starting point to base your fitting around. Your probe tube is your measurement reference point for your fitting, and correct placement ensures quality measurements. Ahead of placement, you should run the tube calibration process to ensure your equipment is correctly prepared for the following measurements. Please see the probe tube calibration video on the Interacoustics YouTube channel for more information on this. You should follow these steps to ensure a good probe tube placement. First of all, good otoscopy. Ensure you know the shape of the patient's ear canal and observe for any obstacles like bags. You can also perform otoscopy once the tube has been placed to get a better placement after readjustment. Second, move your marker on your probe tube to 28 or 30 millimeter, depending on the patient's gender. This ensures that you aren't over-inserting the probe into your patient's ear. And finally, once the probe is placed, observe your REUG to assess your probe placement quality. If you're not within 5 dB of the 0 dB mark at 6 kHz, reassess your probe tube placement. Your REUG measurement allows you to measure the effects of the unamplified ear. This measurement is not necessary for real ear aided response measurements, but it is useful for assessing probe tube placement and also for assessing whether to run a calibrate for open fit in comparison with the REOG measurement. The REOG, or real ear occluded gain, is a measure of the occluded ear. To do this, first insert the hearing aid into the patient's ear and ensure that it is muted or off. Then run your measurement. This measurement can be compared against the real ear unaided gain measurement. And if it looks the same, then you will need to perform the calibrate for open fit measurement. If there is a difference, then you don't need to take any further actions and you can move on to your aided measurements. The calibrate for open fit measurement performs a process to ensure accuracy when fitting hearing aids which could leak sound. These are typically open fits or molds with large vents. Leaving your hearing aid muted, run the calibrate for open fit measurement with the patient placed in position they will be for the remainder of the measurements in this process. This should be done for each stimulus you wish to use for your aided measurements. The measurement result and the curve shown are not relevant, but the process of performing this prepares the system for the aided measurements. Finally, you can move on to your aided measurements and your target match. You can now switch on the hearing aid and begin to fit it. It's advised you run three different stimuli levels, 65, 50, and 80 dB. This ensures that you're assessing the hearing aid at different levels of intensity. On running the different stimuli, you should alter the gain trimmers in your hearing aid software to ensure a good target match. You can use the delta values feature in your Affinity Suite to ensure a good target match. Once a sufficient target match has been achieved at all three levels, the objective aspect of the fitting has been completed. You should now move on to counselling the patient surrounding the amplification and sound they're receiving and include their preferences within the fitting. Thank you for watching this video. For further information, see the Interacoustics Academy website or contact your local representative.